Welcome to the Stormsurf Video Surf Forecast for the week starting Sunday, November 12th. Looking at significant wave heights for the North Pacific Ocean, we see an area of slightly elevated seas in the Gulf of Alaska, part of a continuous pattern of weak low pressure systems dropping from Alaska southward. Also, we see remnant seas in the 18-foot range just west of the dateline, associated with a gale previously there, targeting some wave energy towards Hawaii, and otherwise a pretty quiet pattern. As usual, we'll start our tour looking at jet stream level winds. These winds up about 30,000 feet help support the formation of gales, and when those gales form, help direct their track. We're looking for a trough, a dip in the jet, and it's kind of hard to find anything that looks like that right now. The jet is pushing off Japan, pretty decent, 130 knot winds, but then it gets about halfway out to the dateline. There's the dateline, 180 west, about halfway there, and splits heavily with most energy pushing north, even north of the Bering Sea, pushing into Alaska, then finally falling south from inland, bulging out. This is what you call a backdoor trough, kind of forming a little, so this is a trough here that would help support counterclockwise flow aloft and down at the surface, and that's the hallmark of low pressure. And of course, low pressure generates wind. Wind generates seas. Seas, when they radiate away from the fetch area, produce swell, and swell, when it arrives at your beach, produces surf. But these backdoor troughs aren't very good at doing that, and that's kind of been the situation we've been in. Because the jet is so split, it's amazing, or we're fortunate, that we can even get backdoor troughs. Typically, when the jet's pushing up north of the Bering Sea, it just continues in through Alaska and into interior U.S. mainland, and you just get nothing over the open Pacific. The southern branch is traveling basically south, pushing into Southern California. And in between these two flows here, typically what you get is high pressure, clockwise flow, just like that there. And so this is the only area of interest. Now I'll put this into motion, see how things go. The trough dissipates, but then Monday, a new backdoor trough starts forming. Winds fall south in the, 110 knot range, 120 knot range. So that'll help probably generate some more low pressure into the Gulf there. And that continues into Thursday. Then that trough starts pinching off. But notice we're in Thursday here. Massive split here in the jet. The same thing going on. You know, all the energy pushing north. Southern branch weak and ineffective. Driving over Hawaii. The two flows eventually meet over California and push inland. Anyway, and you just see we get into Friday. Here we go. Another backdoor trough forecast. Falling south, and let's just keep going, see if we get yet more of it into Sunday. And here we are at 180 hours out, a week out, no change expected. So the deal here is the inactive phase of the MJO, actually the active phase of the MJO is trying to organize right over in this area. That's feeding jet stream energy, but it only makes it to about there, and that's where all the jet stream energy fades, the jet splits because it's weak, and then you get this really convoluted pattern, and none of that is really supportive of gale development. You need the jet stream to at least push out to the dateline or so you can get some sort of a trough going off of Kamchatka or the Kuril Islands in this area, and then you could at least get some long distance swell pushing into Hawaii and the U.S. West Coast, but that is not the case right now. We are deeply in the inactive phase of the MJO, and that's forecast to hang for a bit longer. All right, let's get into, let's take a look down at the surface and see what effect the jet stream is having there. Here we go, surface level pressure, surface level winds, and as expected, weak low pressure. What is that, like 1,004 millibars? Barely low pressure at all in the Gulf of Alaska, generating 25, maybe a tiny little patch of 30 knot north winds, sort of aimed at Hawaii, sort of aimed at the U.S. West Coast. High pressure, 1036 millibars there in the Western Gulf. Then some disparate low pressure, a little tiny remaining fetch of 30 knot northwest winds targeting Hawaii. We roll this out. So then this little low is supposed to build up a bit come Monday, right off of, let's say, the Oregon-Washington border, and quickly move inland. And then it's back to the same old thing, low pressure in the Gulf. 25 knot winds, barely 30 knot. You know, normally when we start getting interested when we see 40 to 45 knot winds, and we're nowhere in that ballpark. Here we go, double barrel high pressure come Wednesday, 1040 millibar high over the dateline, 1032 north of Hawaii. That's good for wind swell. Notice 20 knot winds here pushing into the islands. Northeast wind swell, and that's been kind of a steady diet of what's been going on there and for the Hawaiian Islands. Anyway, then theoretically on Friday, a broader, stronger fetch of 35 knot northwest winds, but that quickly peters out as well. I mean, just this pattern's very locked in place. North winds, good for wind swell for Hawaii and the U.S. West Coast. By wind swell, we were talking something less than 13-second period, you know, like 10, 11 seconds, something like that. Oops. And so there we go, and that's the end of it. We're out a week, and not a whole lot depicted. Let's go take a look at the wave models. So we're going to go back in time just a little bit to Friday night. This area right here, a small area of wind started developing, small gale, just west of the dateline, 20-foot seas on Saturday morning building to, well, is that 20, 22, 24-foot seas, building to 26 feet by Saturday afternoon into Saturday evening, and then fading from there, and that's where we are at current now. Small little swell, still pretty good distance away from Hawaii and aimed mostly south. We'll look at this again. Yeah, a bit at the islands, but probably more radiating south of there. And wind swell more than likely going to be coming from the north. From the north at the same time this swell arrives. If this is even noticeable, it'll be amazing. And then here's our current setup. No real seas of interest other than this 18-foot seas here. This is the remnant energy from the Saturday gale. Things fade out. Notice, oops, we get 28-foot seas, almost 30-foot seas, Monday sometime off of Oregon, but all that is mainly shadowed relative to California. Good for large, raw, stormy wind swell for Oregon up into Washington. Maybe something a little cleaner south of Cape Mendocino, but it being so close to land, odds are it's going to be pretty raw. Small area, 20-foot seas right there. Forecasts on Tuesday falling southeast, but that's short-lived. Most of these seas are all in the 17-foot range. And then we get into Friday. Things look a little bit better now. And this is new. This is just off the most recent run of the models. This wasn't here the last run or the run before that. 21-foot seas. This is from those, 35-knot winds in the Western Gulf on Friday. Growing and holding an area and then fading. Still, that's good for some maybe 13-second period swell into Hawaii in the U.S. West Coast if it materializes as forecast, and then that fades out. So pretty much a continuation of the same sort of pattern that we've been seeing. At least there's swell on the charts, nothing huge, but something rideable. It's better than flatness. And now a quick look at the Southern Hemisphere. Not a whole lot going on and not anything really forecast, but we'll just blow through it anyway so you can see for yourself. Seeing is believing. Now, there is Southern Hemi swell in the water hitting California. It peaked out on Saturday, still pretty solid on Sunday. And considering how late in the year it was kind of a miracle. I mean, there were waves in the 2-foot overhead range at top spots in Northern California, and Southern California was doing about the same as well. Maybe a couple of sets, 3-foot overhead at the peak on Saturday. And that was from a gale that traversed the Southeast Pacific over a week ago. But we're looking, and there you go, we saw the end of it. Nothing going on. So South Pacific quiet. We had our last of our late season pulse, and nothing is expected for the future from the Southern Hemi. Next up, let's take a look long term at what's going on with the MJO, Madden-Julian Oscillation, and with El Nino, La Nina. These are the main factors that help push the long-term forecast and hopefully enhance it, specifically the active phase of the MJO or some sort of a turn towards El Nino. Of course, that is not expected, but let's take a look. And as usual, we look at the equatorial winds to see what's going on. East Pacific here, West Pacific here. Here's the equator. Dateline right here. These are winds, 5-day average winds derived from the TAO buoy array, a series of buoys strung across the equator from 2 degrees north to 2 degrees south, mainly used for monitoring El Nino, but They also are pretty effective at helping us find signs of the active phase of the MJO. And of course, the active phase of the MJO, when it occurs, and normally it will occur for three or four week cycles from active to inactive and back and forth, moving from the West Pacific to the East Pacific. When the active phase occurs, it slackens trades in the West Pacific, and that in turn helps impart energy to the jet stream, and that in turn helps get rid of that split pattern that we've been seeing, and that in turn helps fuel gale and storm development in winter months in the Gulf of Alaska and over towards the North Dateline region. Unfortunately, right now, trades, as you can see, out of the east across the entire Pacific, anomalies, differences from normal for this time of year. We're looking at the arrows. Pretty normal over here in the East Pacific, but in the West Pacific, trades are anomalously strong out of the east. That's classic signs of the inactive phase of the MJO, or if it persists long enough, then La Nina, and clearly La Nina is in control. Let's go take a look at the forecast. This is the GFS model, winds for the entire planet, west. So you're wrapping the whole way around, but the date, Kelvin wave generation area, 120 east here to 180 west here, that's the date line, right down the middle of the chart. And these are zonal wind anomalies, only looking at the east-west component of the wind. So when you see purples, and these are anomalies, differences from normal for this time of year. So you just go down between these two tick marks the whole way down. You look, we see yellows and oranges here. That was back in late October, early November. That was westerly anomalies. That was indicative of the active phase of the MJO. But then quickly, by about the 7th of November, we started seeing these purples, blues here. Those are easterly anomalies, anomalously strong easterly anomalies, indicative of the inactive phase of the MJO. Here we are right today. The forecast for the next couple of days, more easterly anomalies. And then as we get, well, right here is 120 east, 180. As we get towards the end of the one-week forecast period, we see easterly anomalies starting to fade out. We don't see any westerly anomalies building, but at least that gives us some hope that the inactive phase of the MJO is moving off to the east like it normally does, and that will at least perhaps let a normal wind pattern set up, and maybe that'll help heal the jet stream a little bit, but not guaranteed. Next, we look at the MJO models, specifically outgoing long-wave radiation models. The areas of blue are areas of more cloudiness, indicative of low pressure, indicative of the active phase of the MJO. And this, per the statistic model, suggests that some form of the active phase of the MJO is trying to develop in the West Pacific and is to hold for the next 2 weeks. That would be a good thing if it were to occur. There's the last fading remnants of the inactive phase of the MJO. Now, the GEFS model doesn't pay quite so rosy a picture. It suggests the active phase, the MJO, is to try to get a toehold in the West Pacific, but then at week two, completely fades out, and we just go into a dead neutral pattern. But dead neutral is better than the inactive phase. We'll take it. Phase diagram charts are another way to track the active phase of the MJO. Assume you're looking down on the North Pole, and the MJO active phase and inactive phase moves from west to east from the Indian Ocean over the maritime continent, consider that like Bali, into the West Pacific, under the U.S., across the Atlantic, over top of North Africa, and then back to the Indian Ocean, doing this whole circle around. The heavy dot is where the active phase of the MJO is. If it's inside this circle, it's considered to be extremely weak. And the green track is the forecast for the next 2 weeks. Per the ECMF model, the active phase of the MJO is in the far, far West Pacific, supposed to make a little bit of eastward headway, but be very weak and not really even get outside of this circle of weakness. So not a whole lot expected. The GEFS model suggests almost no eastward headway and getting weaker over the two-week period. So that correlates pretty well with what we saw on the previous charts. The upper level model, which runs about a week or two ahead of what really goes on down the surface, suggests the active phase is already over the Pacific. The greens are areas favorable for precipitation. And you can sort of see that by, I would say, about the 27th of November, the active phase is supposed to start dissipating. That time, the inactive phase shows up in the West Pacific, very weak, and it too makes its way across the Pacific into about December 17th or so. And then come around the Christmas time frame, slightly before that, let's say mid-December, another very weak active phase sets up in the West Pacific moving east. The CFS model, 850 millibar zonal winds, and again, same sort of deal. The Kelvin wave generation area is right down the middle of the chart, basically. And this runs with past history back here, and here was our active phase back in the late October time frame. Now this looks with blues, that would be easterly anomalies. That means inactive phase. Let's overlay the MJO. Sure enough, there we go. There was the active phase. Here's current, and then this is the forecast moving forward. A broad inactive phase is expected to be in control from now in the Kelvin wave generation area into about mid-December or so. Now notice, even with that, yeah, there's little pockets of easterly anomalies forecast, but also some pockets of westerly anomalies. So we'll just call it basically a neutral pattern. And then as we get into the Christmas time frame, the active phase of the MJO is supposed to wake up, be a little bit more pronounced, and actually get pretty interesting come January. But this model has a tendency to hype active phases 2 months out, and then they never materialize. So we're not going to hold our breath yet. Low pass filter suggests, so the dotted lines are generalized area of high pressure synonymous with La Nina and the inactive phase of the MJO over. So where's the date line? Let's see if we can get this on the chart for us here. Maybe not, but we'll see. There we go. So there's the date line. So your Kelvin wave generation area is in here. Now, what we're trying to get at is, let's say, so once we get into the end of January, high pressure is supposed to be completely out of the Kelvin wave generation area, and low pressure here that's currently, for the most part, been feeding development of any storms in the Indian Ocean is supposed to start making some decent headway into the West Pacific, almost to the dateline, almost filling the Kelvin wave generation area by the late January time frame. So maybe some hope, but again, I don't know if you really want to believe a model that's forecasting something 3 months out. But that's what we're grasping at straws, and we're hoping that for that to be true. Next up, we look at subsurface ocean temperatures, West Pacific here, East Pacific here, and as we've been seeing for months now, warm water, not a whole lot of it, balled up in the far West Pacific. And all that warm water is pretty much from 160 west and points west of there. As you get into the East Pacific, very shallow warm water thermocline, indicative of La Nina. Looking at anomalies, differences from normal for this time of year. In the West Pacific, warmer anomalies at depth, up to 2 degrees now. That's a good sign. A little bit of warmth building at depth. But in the East Pacific, cool anomalies down to minus 4 degrees below normal. Still well in control. Working, and you can see right here between, where is that? It's about 110 to 140. Working their way up to the surface. East trade's blowing hard here, so that's causing upwelling, and it's sucking this cold water up to the surface, making a cold surface pool on the equator, which in turn inhibits evaporation, which inhibits moisture movement up and heat energy up into the upper atmosphere. And that really is what kind of feeds the inactive phase of the MJO and La Nina. Anyway, the dividing line is right about there. What is that? 160 west between warm water, cool water. So the East Pacific, definitely cooler than normal at depth. Another model showing the same sort of thing. So there is up here. You can actually see these are the buoy lines with the sensors on those buoy anchor lines. Okay. And so the actual temperature profile is modeled from those data points. So you can see clearly cooler water in the east, warmer water to the west, brick wall in between them. The two shall not meet until the trades back off and allow some of this warm water to start sloshing to the east. Upper ocean heat anomalies. Last year at this time, we were in a weak La Nina. Cool water here in the East Pacific. Warm water at depth in the far West Pacific. Here we are this year. A broader, a little bit more intense area of cooler water, but at least a little bit of warm water starting to build in the West Pacific. But there's no expectation that any of that's going to move its way off to the east anytime soon. Then we take a look at what's going on at the surface, and the picture is not pretty. Here is Peru, Chile's down here, Ecuador there, the Galapagos right there. This is the equator. Blues, cooler than normal waters, of course, driven by harder than normal easterly trades, which cause upwelling, well-defined, cool footprint from Peru off the Galapagos over to a point, here's Hawaii, point south of Hawaii. Pretty much that's typical, classic La Nina, not necessarily super strong, but a respectable La Nina is indicated. The good news is the trend, the 7-day trend per this chart shows you where, now this is not long term, this is just what's happened in the last 7 days. Things are warming slightly along Peru, meaning things aren't getting colder. And the patches of blue, which were much stronger last week, have backed off considerably, and there's a little bit more sense of warming going on. So if La Nina was pulsing, it seems to be on the backside of that pulse now and maybe giving up some ground. But here's the actual anomalies, high-res sea surface temperature anomalies, a clearly defined cool pool with temperatures, maybe down to 2 degrees below normal, well-established from anywhere from North Chile off Peru, the Galapagos, heading south of Hawaii all the way to the dateline. This is a typical La Nina signature. And of course, this cool water, of course, stomps on evaporation, therefore stomping on feeding the jet stream. So whatever the jet stream is going to do, it does it right about here. And then the split point would be somewhere around the dateline or even just east of the dateline. And that's exactly what it's doing. And until either the active phase of the MJO wakes up and develops and pushes the jet stream a little bit and pushes the split point to the east, or La Nina dies, then you just end up with this split jet stream pattern, both in the northern hemi in the winter and in the southern hemisphere in the California, Hawaii summertime. And then that, of course, means less storm production, and that's exactly what's been going on. So what effect is La Nina or this cool pool having on the atmosphere above it? Well, we look at the Southern Oscillation Index, and it is the difference in pressure between Darwin, Australia, and Tahiti. Positive numbers suggest the inactive phase of the MJO, meaning more high pressure in the Tahiti area. Now, the good news is right now, the numbers are dropping a little bit, still positive. I mean, you can look through here and see the trend's definitely positive, but not strikingly so. The 30-day average used to monitor the MJO, it was up in the 13 range, is now down to 6.98. So that's good. That's suggesting maybe that the active phase of the MJO is not quite as strong as it was. And then the 90-day running average used for monitoring La Nina, El Nino, holding steady at about 8.01. When you get up into the positive range of 10 to 12, maybe 15, then you're in stronger La Nina territory. We're working our way there, but notice for the past month, it's been in between 7 and 8. So it's not building particularly strong. We'll call this a mid-grade La Nina. The ESPI index is another way of monitoring the strength of La Nina, but rather than measuring differences in pressure north of Darwin and north of Tahiti, it's actual precipitation anomalies, specifically in this area. And remember, this is where all the cool water is. So the delta is, or the index is -1.12, meaning less precipitation than normal here, as one would expect. Here's the rainfall anomaly for the last 30 days. And you can see very dry here, no indications of precipitation. Here's the actual average rainfall, and you can see very dry in that region with cool waters. That would be expected. These are all typical signs of La Nina. Here is Nino 1.2 Sea Surface Temperature Index. This is the area just off of Peru, not the official monitoring region, but you can see here over the past month a steady downward trend. We're down at 1.95, basically 2 degrees below normal. That's pretty cool. And all it takes is half a degree, really, to get things going towards La Nina, cooler than normal half a degree. And we're down at almost 2. But let's go check out the official Nino 3.4 monitoring area. And here we are. The latest value, -0.8, 8/10 of a degree below normal. The trend, maybe inching its way down, But it doesn't look like we're on some rocket pattern heading south. If anything, it's a slow, gradual cooling. Don't know that we're even going to get that much cooler, maybe down to 1 degree, just eyeballing this. And then finally, here's the forecast for the official Nino, El Nino monitoring region, the Nino 3.4 region. Where was that? Early October, we were half a degree below normal. By January, we're supposed to be down to about 1 degree, maybe moving to 1.1 degree below normal. So that's officially, that would put us in La Nina territory. The official NOAA forecast came out the other day, and they too said odds are good that, you know, I think it was 80% that we're going to be in La Nina this winter. So no big surprise there. And then, of course, once we get out of that, it'll take us the better part. We'll be into July before things return to normal. So probably not a whole lot expected good this year relative to storm production with La Nina in control. But the good news is La Nina does tend to produce these backdoor troughs, and the backdoor trough pattern in the Gulf of Alaska has been pretty productive in terms of wind swell, 10-11 second period wind swell pushing into California and Hawaii. We expect more of that for the next week or two. Beyond that, it's going to take the active phase of the MJO developing in some significant fashion before we get any real change in the jet stream. It is the split jet stream that's limiting everything right now. Backdoor troughs, as you get further into winter, though, the good news is they help to push cold air down the California coast. They also, when accompanied by precipitation, tend to help promote snow production in the Sierra, which would be good for California's water situation and, of course, for skiing. And La Nina years, typically, Pacific Northwest does pretty well. Whistler down into Washington, even in Mount Bachelor, that kind of area. Details, a little bit early to know exactly. But that, you know, and then you get into some of the inland Pacific Northwest areas as well. The Tetons do pretty well during La Nina years. So that might be something to look forward to if you're into skiing and boarding. Anyway, that's it for this week. We'll do this again next week. Same time, same channel. Thanks for watching.